Okay. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
So today we will be going into Unit 4. We are not yet finished with for loop and while loops. We need to still proceed with some of the examples. So anyway, we got many exercises in that website which we are doing, and along with that, I want to give a few traditional and also my own created problems to you. So what we do is that daily we will take 3 problems from the website and another 2 additional problems from my side. So what I will do is that I will ask you to create the folders, and in each folder you need to keep the date. For example, you create a folder that it is PSP. So to make yourself more good at programming, you need a lot of practice now because you are in your initial levels. So what you do is you create a folder naming it as PSP. And after that, in that folder, you create subfolders. That means you create a subfolder and name it as the date in which you are doing the programs. Next, what you do is that after you finish those 3 programs from the website, or 1 or 2 programs that I give you daily, which was created by me, you just paste them all into that folder. I hope you understand. So I just pictorically represent it. One second, I will just close the door and come. Okay. Right. Let me show this one. Okay, you just create a folder daily. From here onwards, we are coming to the end, so we need a lot of practice now. So you have a folder which says my assignments PSP something, your name, and when you click on this folder, you should create some folders with the dates. For example, today's date is this one, 2021, and the next folder will be 12/2/2021. So like this, we start doing these things, and lab is also part of accepting our practical assignments. Lab can be used for only just evaluation or doubts or questioning something. But every day you need to have a little bit of practice, at least 1 hour a day. So I encourage that. So I want your folders to be like this. And at last, I will create a repository in GitHub. So I will tell you how I will create it and how you can upload it. Now the next thing is that you just sync this folder which you have created, which contains all the folders like this, with the GitHub, and the final check will be done by me using a program. So what this program does is whether all the programs have been finished by you. So I will write a small script for that. And also it will check the plagiarism using Moose software, which is invented by Stanford. So I got the key for checking the plagiarism. So everybody has to do the program on their own. So this is compulsory. So this is how you will create your folders and keep it ready. I will tell you the daily instruction. Please be in touch with our WhatsApp groups. I will tell you what programs you need to do, and I will also pass you the programs which I have created for myself to make you do those programs. Okay, so this is the daily work I am keeping for our batch. So you should get ready for that. So if you are daily practicing, not a problem. Even if you daily practice it, you divide them based on what I say. Clearly, you divide your programs that you have done already. Save them in this type, because I am telling the instruction like that. For example, today I will ask you to go to codecheck.io website and do the problems 1, 2, 3 in the subheading loops without functions, for example. Okay, then you will do all those three programs, and also I will pass on one or two programs which I create, and you do those programs and keep it in a folder 11-2-2021. That's all. And tomorrow, like, so I give you a daily work to you, and you have to do and perform these works. So I want a lot of practice from your side, and that is the reason. And wherever you got doubts, we shall discuss it. And like yesterday, we have, day before yesterday, I think, we have seen that one problem is not good. We will also solve that problem later on. But I think some test cases might fail. If most of you are getting the same failure, then we will just proceed by keeping it aside. But most of the time, almost all the test cases are correct in this website, which I have tested, and they should work properly.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, we want Tell to me. Do code in VS Code or any?
As you wish, you can see, for example, the website which you are in, right? You can write the code directly in that, okay? And okay. You can pass cases. After you pass the test cases, you copy the entire code and put it in your VS Code and save it as .py file. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
And programs which I give you, which I create for myself for your exercises, you can directly do it in VS Code. There will be no test cases for them. You can directly do it in VS Code and save it in the folder. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So finally, why I'm telling this folder, because once you create all your folders, and by the time we stop all the assignments that you have done or regularly, we can directly sync with our GitHub account. You can create a repository in GitHub and just simply upload them everything. You just push the changes. So what I do is that I will write a script which can download all your folders and see whether all the programs have been done correctly or not. And then finally check the plagiarism and award you the marks. This is what I'm planning.
So you are not audible.
Yes, sir, you are not audible.
So initially you have to do your work.
Sir, you are not audible.
Sir. Not audible, sir.
I'm sorry, I got a phone call, that's it, it was disturbed. Let me share the screen again. Okay, right. So am I audible to you all again?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
This is the way that you create your folders, that's all. And I will go to the topic now. So the fourth unit after your loops and your functions that we have gone through until now is the remaining data types. The remaining data types are something like, and until now we have seen something like we have an integer type, we have a float type, we have a string type, right? And now we will also look into some of the most complicated data structures, which might also be the data types, such as the list, the tuple, the what we say set, the dictionaries. So these things we will go through, and for each one, we will go through what are the functions that are there. I think in the last few classes, we have also discussed about the lists while we are discussing about the for loops, which are already uploaded in the YouTube. So we shall go for the functions. I think I have introduced to you about index, I think. I don't know. I forget whether I have introduced index function or not. Can anybody remind me, did I introduce to you the index function of the list?
No, sir.
Yeah, fine. So we have this list functions, the tuple functions, the set functions, and the dictionary functions. And based on this, now we create some problems and programs which we can solve through them. So after creating the data types, we have some of the functions which are very useful, like the iter tools, we have a chain, we have zip. These all things should also be covered by us. After we go through these data types initially, then we come back to our loops and while loops. So we just use the functions concept, the loop concept, the data types concept, including these functions to solve some of the most complicated problems that we have. Right now, let us go to the data types. The first one that we go through is a list. So I think earlier we have discussed, can anybody remind me what is exactly a list?
Like array, sir.
Yes, it is like array. So a list, I have discussed that it is a contiguous memory allocation. But unlike C and C++, where we have some data type called array, and these arrays are actually fixed. In C programming, generally we do it like this, int a of 5. Or we can also give int a of 5 is equal to, we write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Like this we write down. So if this is the case, this is a static memory, and hence we have declared this as 5 numbers fixed. You cannot expand the 6, 7 into this array. We just create a memory of 5 contiguous allocations like this, and we just store 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There is no provision to expand the memory until unless you call it like a dynamic memory allocation. Even if it is dynamic memory allocation, where your array can be expanded in C and C++, still it needs a fixation of array size. Now the flexibility with list is that the list never demands you to previously mention the size. It is as such. You can just go for creation like this. Simple. I hope you understand. So let me check out like this. How you can create a list based on this. So in C programming, when I want to create an array, what I do is simply like this. I can say int a of 5. This is a simple declaration. So while declaring itself, you need to tell that the size should be fixed. This much amount of size should be given. And that size only will be accepted. Either you modify the array with new numbers or you want to delete some numbers, still the size will be the same. But the declaration of list in Python is very simple. If you say student is equal to like this. Now, in this case, you need to understand one thing. The student itself becomes a list. So the student is a variable which belongs to the data type called a list. So initially, nothing is created actually. You see how I will show you. Now, when you visualize it, you can understand that, yes, an empty list has been created. So there is some pointer that was created, and you also have the ID for it. You also have a memory for it. That means a small memory has been created for it initially without any values inserted. So when you say something like student like that, let me explain in the Jamboard. So when I said s is equal to this one, what happens is s becomes a variable, right? It is referring to an address space, maybe 1101, but nothing is actually there in this. Nothing is actually there in this. It is empty. But whenever you want to create a value or insert a value into that, all values will be inserted in this address space. Simple thing. You bought a web, a site corner, you bought a site, right? Nothing is there in that site. A barren land is there. And whenever you want to construct a house, that land is available to you, some plot number, right? The same thing happens. Now S is given an address, and told that whenever you want to refer to S and add or insert a value, all values will be inserted into the address space referred by 1101. Ante ikkada matke manam values ni insert cheyagalam. So let us see what is this particular one in your Python. So you have that ID, that means the address. So I will simply say student is equal to like this. You see, just brackets. You can see the zoom. Just brackets. And I will find out the ID of student. Yes, I have an address. I have an address. So simply if I give A or something, see, A is not referring to anything. So it will say that A is never defined. Once a variable is starting to refer something, then that will be having an address. So the student is referring to an address space, which is 444221952. So this is the identity of that address space. So whenever you want to insert some value into that, then all the values will be stored in a memory space, which is identical with 444221952, which is the address of that particular memory. That's what you need to understand. So let me go through this. So I want to go for the first function called index. So I will tell you why this function is used and how. So one thing you need to remember that everywhere the syntax is very important. Syntax is this one. For the list, the syntax is this. So why do I use list dot index? Why this dot is used? This is the important aspect that you need to understand. Why this dot is used, and why I'm using this list, and why I'm using this index, and what are these three parameters that I have? Now, with our explanation, we need to clarify everything. Let me first come to this, why I'm using a dot operator, right? Coming back to our old concept of class and objects, let me consider something like human.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Tell me. Sir, like, can you say what is the difference between list and index once, sir?
I will tell you. I will tell you after explaining this. There is no difference, yes, between list and index. Index is a function that can be used. I will tell you what is index and what is actually an element. You need to ask the difference between index and an element. Okay, list is a data type. So I will explain, yes, everything. Sir. Maybe your question will get clarified. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Let me have
sir.
Yes, tell me.
Sir, are all the values of a list are having the same address?
Not same address, but you need to remember that. For example, if I have an array, I think I told you this example earlier in Raptor. If, for example, you are having an array A, so you have declared something like this int A of 5 and having 1, 2, maybe I will say 10, 20, 30, 40 and 50. If this is the case in an array, now this 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 will be stored here. And this 10 is an integer, right? In C and C++, each integer will hold 4 bytes of memory. 4 bytes of memory in the recent compilers. So this is 4 bytes of memory. Might be this is having an address 1101. After 4 bytes, it will be having, because an address will be given to each byte. You need to understand that the minimum amount of memory that you get in a RAM is a byte. Okay, the least amount of memory is a bit. But we do not consider bit because bit might be either 0 or 1, that's all. So if you consider 8 bits, it is now turned as 1 byte. The 8 bits is turned as 1 byte. Now every byte will have an address. Maybe byte number 1 is having 1101. Byte number 2 is having 1102. byte number 3 is having 1103, byte number 4 is having 1104. So all four addresses will be occupied by one integer called 10. And the next address will be 1105 after four addresses, right? After this, you will have 1109. If you have an idea about C and C++, you can observe these addresses. You can call the addresses of each one. So the next thing is after four, what is the next address that we will have? Is it 1313 and so on. Now, if somebody asks you, what is the address of array A? Actually, A is pointing to this. Now you need to tell one answer. The address of array A is the address of the starting value of array. So what is the starting value of array in this?
1101.
So what is the address of 10?
1101.
10 occupies might be 1101, 1102, 1103, 1104. But still, these are discarded actually. This is the case that is considered. So 1101 is the address of 10, 1105 is the address of 20, 1109 is the address of 30, and so on. I hope you also understand why we need 4 bytes to store 10. Because 4 bytes in the sense it is nothing but 32 bits, you see. Either 0 or 1, which is switched on and off. To accommodate all these 32 bits to adjust a largest number in the 4 bytes, if we switch on all ones, have something like 400 crore change integer. So this much big number you can insert into instead of 10 in this place. So I think you understand this particular one clearly, because if you just put
yes,
on
sir. All yes. The,
so that means each byte and 4 bytes are there, and all the bits are either filled with 0 and 1. It will form either 10 as a number, it will form a 400 crore also a number, which is the largest number we can accommodate in those 4 bytes. Even though whatever the number might be, the starting address of a 4 bytes will only be considered as the address of a particular integer. And among the array of integers, maybe like this you have, right? So 10, 20, 30, 40. And among the array of integers, the starting address of the first element will only be considered as the address of array. Because you're just pointing to, right? You're just pointing to. For example, if somebody asks you where is Geetam, a GIT, somebody shows you to the gate of the Geetam. Once you are at the gate, from there you can sequentially search for each building and go through those and find out that, okay, ICT Bhavan is here. The same thing. You just point to the first address, that's all. From there you jump from one element to the other element. That is the reason why we say like this. Simple example is apartment, where you will have addresses maybe 54-10-11/1, 54-10-11/2, and so on. If somebody asks you what is the address of your apartment, you naturally give the first plot's address, right? From this, it will continue 2, 3, 4. The same thing happens. So coming to your question, like arrays, even the lists also refer to that. That means, here in this case, if this is the number that is given, we need to understand that it is the address of the starting number. Maybe I will just show you this one. So if I had student is equal to 1, okay, the same address, 10, 20, 30, 40. This is how I have taken. Now I will find out what is student of 0? What is the value of student of 0?
10.
So now if you have student of 0, the index is 0 here and the value is 10. Now the student of 0 is 10. So fine. Now I will find out the address of student of 0. Okay. Now I will find out the address of student. So here what it does is, actually this is taking in a different way. The address allocation of C, C++ and Python is a little bit different. Actually what it says is that it is allocated to an address. So it is referring to only the first byte, and actually the 10 is stored somewhere else. And so it is referring to that address. I will tell you, see how it happens when we go to the sublists also. The concept that you need to understand is, most of the time, the address of the first element will be the address of the entire array in the arrays concept. In the list also, each element will have its own address. Let us see ID of student of one. You see, the address is slightly different, but see how, what is the difference between this address and this address? 0 ki 1 ki and the difference in the children? Almost all the series is the same, right? Almost all the series like 4, 4, 3, 8, 3, 22 is the same. So it is going sequentially. It is going sequentially. Let us go with ID of 2. This also, see, the series is the same, but there might be some difference that you are seeing here. How much of...
320, sir.
Yeah. After 112, you get 432. After 432, you get 752. I think there is a uniform gap between them, right?
20. Yes, sir.
So actually...
320.
Yes. In C and C++, you have a clear-cut memory of difference. Like if you are declaring a particular array as integer, it will be surely that the difference between them is only 4 bytes. The difference between them is only 4 bytes. But now we have a lot of difference here. The reason is, list is not a monopoly. It is not a uni data type. Like for example, if you say in arrays concept in C, C++, you say it is an integer array, it is a float array, it is a string array, or it is a character array. But list is a multiple data type array. You can adjust a string, then immediately write an integer, then immediately write a float, then immediately write a string or a character in the same list. So that is the reason why this much of difference is kept inside that. And one thing I want to tell you, that this address is holding this address. That is the reason why you have. See, what how I can tell is that, okay, I will just...
Sir, is it the same list that we have studied in C++? It contains two parts. One contains value, the other contains the address which is referring to.
Yes, that's correct.
Like there was a chapter in our class 12th.
Pointers, right? Are you saying about pointers?
Yes, sir, pointers.
Pointers concept. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Actually, in Java and Python, the pointers have been just put underlined because, you know, in C and C++, pointers are direct to the users. So because of this, when you do a small mistake with the pointers, the entire system will crash down. So that is the reason why the pointers have been subdued in Java and Python. They are not visible to you, but inside they work like the pointer concept. Okay, Saurabh, I think you understood.
Yes, sir, got it. Got it, sir.
S will be pointing to an address which is 444, 222 something, and this holds this one. What is this one? 4438, 322 series, something. So 4438, 322, some 112. This is what it holds. And this is referred to this. It's a little bit complicated. No need to go down into this. And this is 4438 222 3112. The next one is 4438 222 425 something. And this is where your 10, 20, 30, 40, and 50 is stored actually. Okay. So I hope you understand why we call this. This is referring to a particular address. Okay. Coming back.
Yes.
Yeah. So now let me talk about index. I will give some values here. The same 10, 22, 34, 55, 65. Now let us execute this one and see what will happen. So now you see that when you execute this, simply there are two memories that we have. One is frames, the other one is object. Okay. Now, if I print this student, if I print student itself, what should happen is that the student is referring to the address of 10 indirectly, and from 10, every value will be printed. So that is the reason after creating a memory. See, when you cross this fourth line, a memory has been created in objects, and so the entire thing has been created. Okay. And the next thing is you have a print student, right? Now, I will just execute it, and you see, after creating the memory, the entire list has been created. And now you might get a doubt, what are these frames and what are these objects? Why we say objects and why we are storing like this? Why can't we store the student entire list in the frames itself? Now, I want to tell one thing is that this is called a global frame. So all the variables which are referring to a particular object are actually stored in the global frame like this. And the next thing is these objects are stored in the object. And how many of you have got a doubt why we call this as an object? Actually, what is an object actually? I need to anyway discuss with you about the class and object concept that you will understand. So for that, I will give a small hint for this so that you will understand it definitely. So why we are storing the list with some pointer and storing it in the objects. Why we actually call this list as an object. This list is nothing 20, 34, 55, and 65. And why we are storing it as an object. Now coming back to our explanation. Now we have something called human, right? What is this human actually? A human is a concept, right? It's a concept. It's a class. When I say Kranti, in the terms of our programming, we call it as an instance or object. Object in the sense that exists in the real world. Human doesn't exist actually, but Kranti exists as a form. And Kranti is collection of organs, right? Kranti might be many people. Okay, do you understand that? Somebody might say, Sadhu will ask you that, who are you? You will say, I am Kranti. Then that person will say, you are not Kranti, but who are you? We have this comedy scene in one of the Telugu movie, I think. Every time he asks everybody that, who are you? Who are you? If they say the name, he says that is your name, but who are you? So this is where you need to understand the class and the object concept. When there is a human has certain properties and has certain functions. The functions might be you will run, you will walk, you will talk, and you will sit, you will play, everything. These are the functions that you do. And the properties, something like you have two legs, two hands, and you walk on legs is one property. And you know, you have a twisted tongue and so on. Okay. So if Kranti should be turned as human, turned means something like I want to say, if I say Kranti, I am a human. I need to satisfy all these things. If I cannot talk and I am barking, I will say, okay, I can run, I can walk, I can sleep, I can play, but I am a dog. I am not a human if I am only barking. So based on the shape, that means the property, and based on the functions, you say that you are belonging to a certain class. The class always gives you the concept. For example, if you say a college is a junior college, why it is categorized as junior college? Why didn't everybody say it as a university? The reason is university has certain functions and properties. So that is the reason why Geetam is termed as university. Some Chaitanya or Narayana are termed as something like a junior college. They're not universities, right? So based on the functions and the properties, we turn the objects. Now my question is, if somebody says Kranti is an object, I don't say Kranti is an object. Kranti is not an object. Kranti is actually a collection of organs which are actually in a shape. Okay, like how I turn the list as like this. A list is a collection of elements which are in this shape. And we humans, each human is an object. You, me, and everybody is an object in this world. And we are part of the class called human. Just to refer to us, you cannot say, hey, collection of organs, you come here. You cannot say like this, right? For everybody. Why I'm calling Saurat, why I'm calling Paul, why I'm calling Arun or Arjun or Giri or something. Why I'm calling the names? Because for this collection of organs, I named as Kranti. For this collection of organs, I named as Saurat. For this collection of organs, I named as Paul or something. So the names are not you actually. You need to remember the names are only the reference variables referring to you as an object. Did you understand? So when you consider something like, when I say something like this, student is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4 elements. Now student is a name given to the collection of elements, and this is called an object. Then you might ask me, sir, okay, if you call this as an object, then what is its class? Can anybody tell me what is its class? What is its class?
1, 2, 3, 4.
No, I'm asking
List. Class. The global
List.
No. Yes, somebody said list. So if somebody said, what is its class 1, 2, 3, then if I say your class is heart, liver, kidney, you cannot agree, right? You are classified as human. The same thing, the shape of this and the way you are arranging the values in between these things, it is turned as a list object. Somebody has declared the list to be within the square brackets and you have some elements in it. Element 1, element 2, element 3 to element n. This is how a list will be appearing. And list has some functions like index, count, remove, append, extend, and so on. Like how your humans have run, play, talk, sit, like that. So these are properties and these are functions of the list. And the way you arrange this one, like 1, 2, 3, 4, the way the shape is arranged, this is the real existence in your memory. Like how we are existent on this earth. Human doesn't exist. Human is a class defining that the human classified object should appear like this. But we are the real existence on this earth. The same way 1, 2, 3, 4 is existent in your memory. And so it is called object. Object is a real-time existence. And if you ask me what class it belongs to, I will say it belongs to the class called list. The class called list. So this is the reason why we say that the data types can be considered as classes. If somebody say A is equal to 6, I will say A is referring to an integer value. So here 6 is an object which is belonging to the class called integer. So that is the reason why A is referring to. A is not considered as. A is only a reference, like Kranti referring to me, Saurat referring to somebody, Paul referring to somebody. Like A is referring to this existence called 6. And 6 is belonging to a class called integer. And simply you can also say what A is belonging to. Because A is referring to this existence. So A is a name given to 6. And if you ask what is the class of 6 and what is the class of A, also will get the same answer. So int is a class. Integer is a class which holds minus infinity to infinity values. We don't know what is the maximum value that you can store in Python. We cannot judge it. Like C and C++. If you ask me in C and C++, based on the compiler, I can tell you what is the maximum value based on the number of bits it can accommodate. but I cannot say it in Python. It's not fixed. It can be dynamic. So a float, it can store all decimal points. Whatever, for example, if I ask what is the class of 5.6, you need to say it's float. And you give a name like A is equal to 5.6. In the same sense, you will have the list also as a class, the set also as a class, tuple also as a class. Why? No, you understand why we call data types. Like the class integer float, which we call data types, we also call the list, set, tuple, and dictionary as also data types. Now let us go through this Python one. Python 3. Now, if you just look into this, I will just tell you. I say A is equal to 6. Now I'll prove that why it is called class. Now if I say type is a function which actually shows you what exactly the class of a particular A. See, have you seen what it is giving? It is not giving actually a data type. It is telling that class integer. So it says that, it clearly says that type A is belonging to the class integer. Let me try the other way also. Type of 6. See what it is giving? So 6 is an object that is in a real existence, and A is a name given to the real existence called 6. So either you refer to A or either you directly refer to the real existence. Both ways, it will be given as integer class. So somebody might point to me, they don't know my name. They point to me and ask me somebody that, who is that? Somebody will say, he is a human, right? So I'm directly pointing to a collection of organs, a shape there in a real existence. I can also call him by name, right? I can say, who is Kranti? Kranti is a human. Right? So I can call by name that was given, which is called a variable. So name here is a variable. So Kranti is a variable referring to me. Saurit is a variable referring to some body. Paul is a variable referring to other body. Right? Here, A is a variable referring to a real existence 6. And I can also say FL is equal to 5.6. And I will type what is FL. I'm calling it by name, a variable referring to the real existent. But if I call directly, if I point out directly like this, what is the class of the object 5.6? This is the way. So technically, the object is 6 and A is a referring variable. A is a referring variable, right? But what is the class they belong to is integer. Here, the float. The same way, now I will type something like student, something like list, LST is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now I will ask what is the type of LST. So have you seen that it is giving that it belongs to the class called list? I can also type of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yes? The entire existence is itself a list. Now I will type something like type of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You see, I am giving in a different shape, right? I am giving in a different shape, and based on this, it is classified as a set. See, what is the shape that is differing? You are having a flower bracket. Are you understanding? Are you able to see the zoom?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you are having a flower bracket and it is termed as set. So this shape is called set. For example, you will show to a chimpanzee and say, if it is a human, nobody will believe. Its shape is entirely different. Though some functions are matching with us, but still its arrangement of organs and the shape is entirely different. So we termed it as a class belonging to a monkey or something. It is not equal to humans.
Sir?
Yes. Tell me.
Sir, if we use the type function for any object present in the list, will it be giving the list or It will be giving integer, sir. Means if you use
example, I will just check out your own problem. So I will come back again so that it will be clear for you. Okay, now you said that LST is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now you want to find out the type, right? So type of L of 1. What is L of 1 actually?
Two.
What is L of 1? 2, right?
Yes, sir.
So
LST.
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 Yes, sir.
LST, yeah. What it is giving?
Integer.
Integer. So, this particular one belongs to a particular class called integer. Individually, the value is an integer value, but a collection in a form is actually human. For example, you take a heart. Heart is an element in our body, right? If you take a heart and ask what is it, nobody will say it's a human, right? They will say it's an organ. Because heart is an object of a class called organ. Something is defined as an organ because it has some properties satisfying and some functions that are there. So each object in this world and along with something in programming also has a class in it. So the real existence are always called objects and the concepts are always called the classes. I hope you understand the difference between a class and an object, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now coming back to our thing. Now that is the reason why actually you store it in objects. Most objects like lists, tuples, sets, and dictionaries are very big in data type. So the data size is very big. You can accommodate as many values as possible because entirely it is dynamic. No fixed memory. You can expand like anything, like the large empires that expanded in the ancient world. There are no boundaries to this, expansion. So that is the reason we have a separate memory called objects, where we can just store them. For small objects, you can directly store in the global frames, like A is equal to 6, B is equal to 7, because we know that it is only one value. And a list is ever expandable. Okay, you can expand to, the fourth, sixth element, seventh element, to 100th element, to 1000th element. So list can go on expanding. And that is the reason why it was given separate memory and the memory is called objects. So all objects are stored in here. Now coming to our function called index. So if I want to find out the index of an element 34, the index of an element 34, I can do that. So I had another syntax. You can simply give list dot index of 34. So you can just give one element, that's all. This is possible. You can just give one element. So now tell me how I can do that. I can do like this, student dot index of 34. Now, why didn't I use this? Can anybody tell me whether this is correct? Sorry. Or this is correct? Which one is correct?
Student.
Later
student.
Student.
So all of you agree for student, right? So if I ask somebody something like human dot run, this is one function. Kranti dot run. Which one is correct?
Kranti dot run.
Kranti dot run. Kranti real existence. Kranti can only run. Human is a concept. How human can run? We said that Kranti real existent. So Kranti belongs to the class human. So he can access all the functions of human. So if he is classified as human, he should satisfy all the functions that human can do. That means it is common to all the humans. You, me, and everybody, and all the people sitting in this class can run, walk, sleep, talk, and you can dance, you can listen, you can do, or you can write, you can invent something, languages, you are intelligent. So these are all the things that are satisfying in the human class. So you should not say the class itself. Only in syntax we say something like that. But you, in a real world, you should always refer to the objects themselves. you can also do like this. Maybe you can say, okay, sir, why can't I do like this? Shall we try out what will happen for this? Okay. Let me see what will happen. Just a trial. I think I did not print it, right? So I can print. And we have a return value, right? When we call this one, we have a return value because it is returning the index of this. So let me check out. Yeah. What is that it has printed for me?
Index number.
Index. So the same thing, I can write it like this. Print student dot index of 34. What is the difference between them? Why?
It's 3 o'clock.
What is this and what is this? What is the difference between these two? Can anybody tell me?
We are writing.
Basically, student is referring to this list.
Yes. So somebody is pointing to me and telling that, hey, you run. This is wait. So if somebody is pointing to me directly, they don't know my name, Kranti, and they're just directly pointing to me and saying that, hey, you run. Okay, this is the example I'm giving to this. And somebody knows my name, Kranti. So they will say, Kranti, you run. So see the difference between them. Somebody is directly pointing to me and saying, hey, you run. And somebody is indirectly pointing to me by calling my name, Kranti, you run. So this is the difference between them. So you can call in either ways. The object should always satisfy the function. So the object can access the function of its class. Because Kranti is human, Kranti can access the function called talk. So I can talk now. That's why I'm talking. That's why I'm classified as human, right? So this is where you need to understand how you can access the functions. So dot is like that, telling that this function index is part of an object referred by a name called student. So it says that, I will just write it in the list. Index of element is a function which can be accessed by the object referred by a name student, okay, which is called variable, right? A student variable, and hence dot is used. And hence dot is used. You're telling that this index function is belonging to a class called list, and student is an object of list. Not directly, you cannot say student, but student is referring to an object which is a part of list, and hence it can access the function called index. So you can write down like that. Okay. And coming to our next parts. Now we have this list, right? And see the syntax. Element and other two syntaxes are also there. You know, the other two parameters like start and end. Let me check out. So if I can say print student dot index of 34. If I say something like 3. Now tell me what will be the answer that comes. You carefully observe the syntax there and tell me what I am doing now. This is actually legal. That means you can only mention element and start also. That's all. That also is legal. But your task is to give me the answer.
So will it be 5?
Why you are saying it is 5?
I'm thinking 3 is the starting index.
No, this is the starting index. Anyway, this is the starting index. I want to search 34 and I have given something like 3 here. This 3 is actually placed in the place of start index.
Imagine. Minus 1.
Search 34 after third index.
34 after third index, but 34 is before third index, right?
I thought like give index of
sir,
all.
Not 65.
No, no. I am only searching for 34. I want the index of 34, but I am telling that you search from the start index 3. Well, let me show you what will happen so that you can determine it. Okay, I have a list in my memory. Now you can see 10, 22, 34, 55, 65. 10 is belonging to the index 0, 22 is belonging to index 1, 34 is belonging to index 2, 55 is belonging to index 3, and 65 is belonging to the index 4. Let's come back. Now anyway, for 34, it will give what is the index. So 2 is already printed. Now we are at the 15th line. Now let us see what will happen. Oh shit, what it has given?
Error.
Value error.
But we should not agree, right? Why should we agree? 34 is present in the list.
We should it is checking error. After third index.
Yes, that's correct. That's correct. So actually, when we give a third index as a start index, it is checking from 55 to end. So when it is starting to check from third index and to the last, like this, it can only see 55 and 65. It didn't see 34. Let me explain you on board here. Now I have a list like this. So it will be 10, 22, 34, 55 and 65 like this. It is having some index 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4. When I write some sentence like this, maybe this is referred by S, okay? S dot index of 34, just like this. What will happen, you know? By default, it is considered as 34, comma, starting index of every list is 0, comma, length of S. What is length of S actually? Can anybody tell me what is the length of S?
Five.
So length of S is 5. So this is what it considers. So it will go from the starting. It will check whether S of 0 is 34 or not. If it is no, discard it. Go to the next element. Check whether S of 1 is 34. No. Check the second one and sees that S of 2 is 34. Fine, it has found out and returned the index 2. And you got your index of your number, right? And what is the next statement I have given? If I give it like this, index of 34, I want to find out the index of 34 element, comma, I have given 3. How it considers is 34, the starting index is 3 and length of S. Remember, until now, whatever we have discussed regarding strings or for loop, what is the end position? Is it up to or including?
Up to.
So it will start checking from the third index. It will check the fourth index and stop here because the length of S is 5. It will not go beyond that. It will only check 3 and 4. What is S of 3? 55. So it will start from here. S of 3 is 55, not equal to 34. Go to the next element. S of 4 is 65, not equal to 34, and not beyond that. So it will say 34 is not present. It cannot see. It's blind. We only asked it to go from here to here. How can it see 34, which is beyond that? I hope you are understanding. Now, if I say something like this, you see, you should tell me the answer. S dot index of 34, comma, 0, comma, 2. Can you find out 34 or will it give me an error?
Errors.
Confounds.
Errors.
The reason is we want to check starting with 0 and up to 2. Up to 2 in the sense, you will go with 0.
10 and 22 will be the answer, no sir?
No. The answer says that answer in the sense, it will check only 10 and 22. It could not find 34. So it will give me that 34, I could not find this value. So it gives me the error. So that's what you need to remember. You see, I will edit this code. This time I give 0 and 2. So this 0 is the start address and 2 is the end address. Whatever the end index might be, it is only up to. So it will only search with student of 0 and student of 1 where it cannot find 34. So naturally it gives me an error, you see. After this, 2 to find. And now you see, check 34 between 0 and 2. Yes, we got an error, right? Because it's only checking the starting address 0, it is 10, so it is not. It is not equal to 34. Next address 1, which is not equal to 34. And stop here. Because we said clearly 2, only up to. Up to 2 only we need to check. So it will only check 0 and 1. It did not find 34. To find 34, for example, if I give something like 3, what will be the answer?
Found 34.
It shows 34.
Yes, it shows the index of 34. You see how it shows. So the index of 34 here is 2, 2. And now you see in the 15th line, we have given 30. Find out the element index 34, 0 and 3. So remember that you are giving an element, not an index. You are giving an element and trying to find out what is the index number of this particular element. Maybe I will say, okay, please find out the roll number of Mahak. So actually your roll numbers are like your index numbers, right? Index number is referring to a particular element. So Mahak is an element, for example, and I'm asking to find out the roll number of Mahak. Yes, it will give me the roll number if Mahak is existent. Otherwise it should return me that Mahak is not there in your section, right? So like that, it will search. Actually, this 34 is an element who has an index. I want to find out whether 34 is existent or not. Now you see, as it has given the number 34, index is 2. It is correct. Right? Now I think you understand about index. Index has 3 arguments in it. That is the element to be searched. What element you want to search? Any number or string or something. Now you can start, you mention where is the start index and you mention where is the end index. Now you might ask me, what is the use of start and end? Why can't we search from the first? Now let me say an example to you.
Sir, one small doubt.
Yeah, ask me.
Sir, in start parameter, can we take negative index?
Yes, you can take. You can take negative index and do it.
Okay, sir.
For example, you take something like student is equal to Kranti, next Kiran, Mandava, next Mohan, like this, your story. It's an alphabetical order. You know it's an alphabetical order. And somebody has said that, okay, the K will be ending at index number 1. Okay, if you look into this execution, you see it in the memory that Kranti will be at 0, Kiran will be at 1, and Mandava and Mohan will be at 2, 3. So you want to find out Mohan. You want to find out Mohan. Why do you check from alphabet A to M? It's a waste of time, right? Somebody has said that, okay, the K end will end. Okay, there is no L or something. After K, the M will only start. And K will end at index 1. So naturally, you just give to find out Mohan, you can save a lot of time by saying print student dot index of Mohan, the element which I am trying to search, and its index number I will start with 2 and to the end. I can close it because by default it will go up to the end if I don't give any end index. If I give end index, it will go only up to that. Now you search for it. And okay, I did not close the bracket. See. So now it will search, it will start at index 2 and search for Mohan. First it will not find Mohan in index 2. So it will go to the next index 3. It finds and gives me the index. You can see it has printed here in the screen. So I think you understand what is the use of start and end index that is mentioned in the function called index. I hope you understand. You go to the next function.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, instead of writing this Mohan like start index, we can also write directly like student square bracket and the index of which element we want.
But how do you know that the index is for Mohan? I want to find out the index of Mohan itself. If I know the index of Mohan, why do I use this function at least? Yes, do you understand that? If I know the index of Mohan, now I can simply write like this. Okay, I can see student dot index of Mohan 2. So what will be the answer that will come for this? If I print this one, carefully observe. For the ninth line, can you tell me what will be the answer?
Bracket will answer.
Mohan, sir.
Yes, it will be Mohan. The reason is the index of Mohan is 3. So student.index of Mohan will return you a value 3. What is S of 3? Mohan. So if I know index, I can use this type of thing. But if I know that I want to find out the index of a particular name or an element, then I use this one. Okay, ma'am, have you understood?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Like I said earlier, example, if I want to find out the roll number of Mahak, I will say, computer, please search me the roll number of a name called Mahak. So the Mahak is an element here and it will search the roll number for me. The same thing happens here. I don't know the index of a particular name or whether it is existent or not in my list. So if it is existent, I ask it to please return the index based on your programming necessity. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
The next thing that we go is append. So append is a function which is very helpful to us to add something into a particular list. So you have something like a syntax, which I will give it now. This is the syntax of a function called append. For example, initially I have just created students. So nenu oka college kattukunnanu. So I have constructed a college. I have registered it as an engineering college. Now I am waiting for the students to enroll into my college one by one. How do they enroll? I just created a space for the students to sit down. Okay. So I have created a space, for example, a classroom, a projector, a board, everything. And I'm sitting and waiting for the students to come. So I just created a class. So nobody will register an engineering college and say that I have 60 students already registered in my college. Your engineering college is only not registered. And how you can register 60 students? No. After registration, after you provide space by constructing buildings, then only people will come to your college. So now let us see how you can include that. So you just created a space now, right? Now after this, to include these, I want to just give it like this. I'll say student dot append of Kranti. So let us see what will happen here. See, the list is including the first student Kranti into it, and he is given an index number 0. Now if I say the next one, student dot append of Kiran. Now you will have the next student also included. So actually this is very dynamic. You can include as many number of things as possible. Now I'll just write a for loop, simple for loop, you see. For I in range 1 and 10, so some numbers, and I'll say student dot append of I. So what you expect the answer will be when I print student? What will be the answer? Total answer of the student list.
Kranti, comma, Kiran, comma.
From 1 to 9.
Yes, 1 to 9. So Kranti, comma, Kiran, comma, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 will be included. Because I am just writing a for loop and saying that every time I want to append I. So let us visualize it how it will be. Okay, we have an empty list initially. Now Kranti is included, Kiran is included. Now see that I value is being changed every time and it is included. So 1 is included, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay, 7, 8 and 9. That's all. You finish it and print students. The student has been printed like this onto the screen. 1 to 9. And this is how you can include multiple data types in a list. Multiple data types in a list. You can accommodate string, you can accommodate number and so on and so. This is how I can also say, I can simply write something like this. So if I want to include all of the items in a list, I can say student dot append of, I want to include the name, student dot append of the rank of MCET, maybe 4000, student dot append of the fee he paid 2.7. So different data types they belong to, right? And student dot append of, he is belonging to a category something. Now let us see whether it will include all of these things or not. Kranti 4000 2.4a. See, multiple data types are included. This is the advantage of lists here. There is no restriction that all the elements in a list should be only one data type. So it is not expecting that all the elements to be strings, or it is not expecting that all the elements to be integers or float or characters. It is expecting different data types to be included in a list, and the list is dynamically ever expandable. Remember, the function append has a very great opportunity to include many, many elements into your list. So for example, imagine a train. Imagine a train. After the last bogey, you can attach other bogey without disturbing the previous ones. This is what appending. So appending in the sense you are not changing the already existing elements. Just you are adding some more elements to the back of already existing. The same thing like train. The new bogey is attached to the already existing bogies of a train in some stations, right? This is called appending. This is called appending. So just appending it. Generally, appending is a word used in the files. So for example, today you have written a story of one paragraph and you got slipped. And you thought that tomorrow I want to include another paragraph. So tomorrow you open a computer and continue writing your story or a novel. So this is called appending a file. But every day when you are waking up and while you are trying to continue your story, your computer is erasing the previous written paragraph, how you will feel? So that is not appending actually. Appending means you are adding something, some more to the already existing. So that is the reason why we call this particular function as append. And remember the syntax that append will have something called item. So we have some things to do in append. I will just show you one more concept in appending. You can actually include a list itself. Let us see how you can include it. Student dot append of 1, 2, 3. See what will happen? What did happen here? What you have observed in this? What is that 1, 2, 3 actually?
Sir, a list in a list?
Yes, it is called a list in a list. But my doubt is, why can't you include this directly 1, 2, 3 here itself? Why you are giving, you are pointing to some other memory location and saying that this is included to this? See, observe it clearly. In 0, you have a value. In 1, you have a value. In 2, you have a value. In 3, you have a value. What are you expecting that 4 is containing? Is it 1, 2, 3 or something else?
So 1, 2, 3.
Yeah. Said
that 4
is
the address of this list.
Yes, that's correct. Actually, you cannot accommodate a list here, right? You cannot accommodate the whole list in a simple single value address space, right? So naturally, what you do, you want to have it in a separate space without any confusion. You have created a separate space like this. And this address has been stored in the index called 4. The address of this has been stored. So you can see how it has printed. It is a sublist, of course. It is a sublist in a main list. But still in the memory, it looks like this. I will just explain you how it will happen. So for example, if I have something like S is a name referring to a particular address called 1100, which is a list. Example, it is holding 10, 20, 30, 40. The index is 0, 1, 2, 3. And this time I want to include another index. What I said, the another index should be 1, 2, 3, something like this. Now, what will happen, you know, this 1, 2, 3 is a list and it appears like this, right? It appears like this. How can you accommodate this list here like this? It is wrong. It is never possible in the memory. You can write it in a diagram, not in the memory. So what technically will happen, you know, it will again create another memory for this list separately. Maybe its address is 3161 something. Its referring address is 3161. And one, oh, I'm sorry. I need to have my charger. Wait a second.
Okay.
Right. Okay. It is referring to 3161, right? It is referring to 3161. And now your 1, 2, 3 will be stored with 0, 1, 2 indexes. Now, where this 3161 will be stored and who will refer to this 3161 in this case? Who will have this value? Actually, S is having 1100. It is referring to this with a list. And in this list, I want to create 123. So where this address is stored?
At fourth index.
Yes, it is at fourth index, 3161. So it is referring to this particular one. So just I will write in this particular one so that you will understand. Okay, this is referring to this. So lists are always independent from each other. But still one list can refer to another list in such. So actually these are values where I am mentioning here. But this is an address. This is an address. So this index 4 of S is holding an address of this. Now there is no way that you can get in the real time that this address will be shown to you. Whenever you say S of 4, it will only give you 1, 2, 3 as the values. That's all. Because it is if S of 4 is nothing but 3161. And what is 3161? It is the list 1, 2, 3. So it will give you the list 1, 2, 3 like this. That's all. So I hope you understand. So this is how the sublists can also be included. So any doubt in this? Any doubt or can we proceed further with another function?
No doubt, sir.
Okay. Now, going back to this. Now, I have another function called extend. Now, I'll just give you something like extend syntax. And you need to understand what is the difference between extend and one second, I have a problem in my computer. Okay, you need to find out the difference between extend and append by looking into this. Let me find out the in syntax, not find out, give you the syntax of this. Can you see what is the difference between them? What is that that is there in append and what is that that is mentioned in extend? In append, what they are mentioning?
Item.
Item. In extend, what they are mentioning? Iterable. Iterable. Let me tell you what is iterable when I show you what happens. So there is another function called extend. Until now, there are three functions that we are seeing: index, append, extend. In this, I say the same thing. 1, 2, 3. What you expect from this? What output will be for the student? Any guess?
Do you expect 1, 2, 3 will be included in that student?
Yeah, that do you, I will write the answer like this. So I have Kranti, so I will write it in 4000, 2, 4, A, next 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. And I want to ask something like, how many of you think that this is correct? Please raise your hand. I want to see how many of you think that this is correct. Whatever I have mentioned. Kranti, 4000, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Okay, I will say one other thing. So how many of you think that this is correct? You can raise your hand. Okay, that's correct. So most of you are actually mentioning this. Okay, thank you. Right, this is correct. Let me go through this. Now you see how it is included. Using append, you had it like a single sub list, but using list, the 1, 2, 3 has been included separately, but the statements are equal. Why? What could be the difference between them? What could append be doing it and what could extend be doing it? Can anybody mention the difference that you got? That can you guess it?
Append means add this particular elements at a particular index.
Mm-hmm.
Extend means assign each number with an index.
Yes. The syntax itself says that in append you have item, in extend you have iterable. What is iterable? Iterable in the sense that, for example, you have few series of numbers. So, for example, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. These are few series of numbers. Now, you are iterating through all these numbers. This is called iterable. Okay, that means if you are given a series of numbers and ask you to read, you will say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So, this extend will do. The more clever one is append. It doesn't read it. It says series of numbers is given to me. I will tell you once more so that you will understand. Extend is a person who is very less intelligent. If I have given him a series, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, this is what I have given to him and asked him, so I am this. Kranti, and I am asking him what I have given to you. This extent will say to me that, sir, you have given to me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So he is reading each number and telling to me that this is what you have given to me. And there is more clever person and a very lazy person happened. He is saying to me, if I am asking what I have given to you, if I give the same thing, he simply says, sir, you have given a series of 6 numbers. See the difference between them. So it is called iterable. Iterable in the sense it is looking into each element minutely and telling to me that you have given me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But he simply says, sir, you have given me a series of 6 numbers or a list of 6 numbers. So consider, he considers the whole thing as one item. He doesn't iterate. That's why I call it as item. So whether you have given a list or a tuple or a set, he considers the whole thing as one item. But extent doesn't consider like that. Extent consider 1 as an item, 2 as an item, 3 as an item, 4 as an item, 5, 6 as an item. So to make it consider each one as an item, it will iterate through all the numbers. But here, in append mode, it actually says that the whole thing is one item. So, if I talk about you separately, for example, you are all sitting in a class. I can simply say it is a, B28 section. The class is B28. So, I am considering you as a whole as an item. But if I want to work like extend, I will say, what is this? I will say, it is containing B28 roll number 1, B28 roll number 2, B28 roll number 3. So I am iterating through all of you individually because I consider each one as an item. So have you understood the difference between extend and append? Yes?
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. So that is the reason.
Sir, I have a doubt in append.
Yes.
Like in the append, in the fourth position, we gave an entire list. So how do we refer to each element of that list in a list? Like for list 3, we will get the value as Kiran or something. But for list 4, we will get the entire list. So if I want an element of that list, that is 1, 2, 3 separately, then how will I do that?
Can I do it like this? Like student dot, sorry, you know already the index is 4, right? Index of yes, this sir. Sublist is 4. Can I do it like this? So that I want to print this one. Let me print it. So did it come to you?
Yes, sir.
Got one. The same way, now I will write a simple for loop for this. What I will do is, for I in range 0, length of student of 4. Because you know that the fourth index of the student will contain a list, you simply say it like this. So what does this mean is that I am trying to find out the length of the fourth index of a list. What is the fourth index of a list? It is a list containing 1, 2, 3. So fourth index of a list is referring to a list 1, 2, 3, right? Containing 1, 2, 3 elements. So I'm finding out the length of student 4. The length of student 4 is nothing but 3, right? Because there are 3 elements, the length is 3. So what I will do now, I will go for just printing it, I. So I is 0, next I is 1, next I is 2 and stop. So every time I want to print student 4 of 0, student 4 of 1, student 4 of 2. You can see, like, you can print it that way. Now the for loop starts. Okay, 1, 2, next 3. All have been printed. So you can simply refer like this. To go to 2, you should say that in student list, go to the fourth index, so student of 4, okay? And in that student of 4, go to the first index. So you simply mention it like student of 4 of 1. So this is how I will write it like this. So you can observe this. So I will write student of 4 of 1. Simple, right? Did you understand?
Yes, sir. Got it. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
So first, you need to go to that index. And from that index, then you need to go to this. It's sub-index. So this is how you will go.
Yes,
because you always need to understand that student of 4 is nothing but it is 1, 2, 3 as a list. And if you want that 3 to be taken out, you can simply go for student of 4. And in that, you want to go for 2. So it is nothing but the value 3. That's how you will. Right. I think if you can understand what is the difference between append and extend, now we will go to the next concept, which is the function count. So why do I require count? Can anybody tell me? What could be the count doing? Can anybody tell me what could be the count doing? Why do I require count?
Find the number of places of a list where there is some value.
Yes, yes, that might be correct. So let me give you that the syntax of count is this. So we will now check out why the count will be used and what is the advantage of count per element. So if you have 100, 30, 40, 450, 500, something. Okay, you have these values. Now I want to find out what is the count of 100. What is the count of 100? So if I say print student dot count of 100. Now it will give me whether it is present or not. So if I say something like print student dot count of 10. So what would be the answers that you expect here?
Error.
No, no. What is the first print that will give you?
So 1.
Will be the answer. Next.
0.
That's correct. So here I will tell the advantage of count when considering the earlier examples. You see? Right? So you got 1 and 0. Now come back to our index problem. Index problem. I'll just remove this. Now I have this set of values. Okay, I want to find a certain value which I need. For example, I will say print student dot index of 30. Of course, this will give me a great value for me. And say print student dot index of 10. Print I am in the next line. Some statements I am printing, that's all. Print the end of program. Okay, now if this is the case, let me execute this. In this scenario, what I am trying to find out is, I am thinking about two numbers and I am trying to find out whether this number is there, and if it is there, find out the index of. See, for example, in telephone directories, now if there is a digital telephone directory, what you will do, you will just type a phone number and say you find out whether this phone number is there or not. If the phone number is there, return the name of the person who is holding the phone number. So sometimes that phone number might not be present. It is already eliminated from the telephone directory or your contact list. If the phone number is not present, what it will give? It will simply say the phone number is not present. instead if you if it gives an error and says you need to switch off your phone and switch on again, you will feel completely frustrated. Now let us see what will happen here. Visualize. First, I have created an index, a list of all the numbers. Next, I want to find out the index of 30. Anyway, it will give me 2. So it has printed 2 here. You can see on the screen. Now see what will happen. Is it going to the next lines? Can anybody tell me? Does it go to 14th line and 16th line? Is it continuing?
No, sir. It
won't. No, sir.
It won't. If it sees that the number is not there in the list, it is simply saying there is an error and it is stopping the program. No, it should not be correct. For example, if you are going to an ATM, you are inserting your card and you are typing some wrong number, it is simply continuing with the program and saying, please enter the correct PIN number. Or otherwise, go out, get out of my way and give the other person a chance. Something. The program is continuing. For example, for the first time you are going to ATM and typing a wrong PIN number, if suddenly at back of you there are another 10 members to withdraw their money, and suddenly it gives you an error and says the program is stopping now, I cannot work now, ATM is shutting down, what will happen? No, you need to make the program continue when you are writing the program. Ante sudden ga abrupt ga eppudu aagipokoddu, it should not end abruptly. It should give a message that I am sorry, your PIN number is wrong, please enter the new one. Right, the same way it should happen. 10 anedi naaku dorakaledu, I did not find 10, so please I will go to the next lines for execution. I could not find what you have given, so simply I can do one thing using count. So using index, it is vulnerable. Index will only be useful if that particular value is present and we are confident about that. అంటే 100 30 40 ఉందని కాన్ఫిడెన్స్ ఉంటేనే వీ నీడ్ టు యూస్ ఇండెక్స్. అదర్వైజ్ వీ షుడ్ నాట్ యూస్ బికాస్ ఇట్ విల్ లీడ్ టు ఎన్ ఎర్రర్. ఫర్ దట్ వాట్ ఐ విల్ డూ, సీ ఇఫ్ స్టూడెంట్ డాట్ కౌంట్ ఆఫ్ 30 ఈస్ గ్రేటర్ దాన్ 0 దెన్ ప్రింట్ స్టూడెంట్ డాట్ index of 30. I'm giving like this, else print the number is not there. See how I am handling it smoothly. Now the next thing I will give the same way, copy paste. This time I am trying to find 10. So if 10 is there at least one time. If 10 is there at least one time, what does it say? That if the count of 30 is 0, it indicates that 30 is not there in the list. So why do you try to print index? You directly go and say the number is not there. The same way I'm trying to do. If the count of 10 in the list called student is greater than 0, then only print index. If it is equal to 0, then I come here and print the number is not there. Let's see what will happen. Visualize the code and I will execute it. This is the memory we have given, 100 30 40 500. In the memory you can focus here. Now because the count 30 is greater than 0, because 30 is existing one time, which is greater than 0, so count of 30 is 1, right? And hence it is going, the red line is going to the 11th line, you see, and it is printing the index. Yes, it is printing 2 for 30. Now it is checking if student.count of 10 is greater than 0 or not. Because it finds that 10 is not there, the count is 0, it will skip this line and directly go to the 18th line. You see? See? And now it will print the number is not present. Now after that, without any error, and the number lakapoyina, it did not give me the error using count function. I am now directly going to 22 line and 24 line without anything. You see, end of the program. There is no disturbance for me during my execution of program. There is no abrupt end. So this is the advantage of your count function. Understood? Any doubt in this?
Sir, but the same could have been done with the index function also. Now that if the value is false, then print this number is not there.
how you say that if values, okay, let me type whatever you ask. Okay, let me check. Tell me what you want to type here.
If student.index.
Student.index.
N. Double equal to.
Double equal to.
False.
False. Okay.
Then print the above. The number is not there.
The number is not there. How many of you will agree with this statement? Will it be correct or not? Anybody contradict it? And can you explain why you contradict? Let me execute this one.
And yes, sir, got it. It will not work.
The reason is student.index of 10, the index function will always return only the index number if the element is present and its index number. So if yes, 10 sir. Is present, if 10 is present in the list, it will find out the index number and return it. If 10 is not present in the list, it cannot find 10 and hence it cannot find its index number and throws you an error. So when you need to use false, when some function is returning you a boolean value, ante index and a function whether it is true, returning true or false. For example, if index function is returning either true or false only, then you can check this type of statement. Okay, but yes, if it's returning some index number and the number is not equal to false every time, false, true or false are boolean data type and the numbers are integer data type, so there is a difference between them. You cannot compare an integer data type and a boolean data type, and hence it is not correct. So in this case we can only go for count. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Right, next we will go for insertion. So now, until now you have seen the functions like append, you have seen the functions like extend, index, count. Now you will go for insertion. So what does insertion mean? What could be the insertion according to you? What do you expect in insertion? So I'll simply give the syntax for what we say insertion. So insert I and then element. Now in this case, I want to say that I is the index and element is either a number or string or list or tuple or any other data type. Anything you can consider. But you want to insert this element into this index I. So for example, I want to insert something in between 30 and 40, maybe a number 20. So how can I insert? So coming to this, I will go 130, 40, 500, right? So let me open a new board. Okay. Now I have a list. And I have something like 100, 30, 40, and 500. Now, these are the indexes for it. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And now something I thought I am missing here. So what I will do is I will just try to insert something in between. So I want to insert 20 in between. So my new appearance should be like this. 100. I'm expecting this to happen. 30, 20, 40, 500. I am expecting this to happen like this. Now in this case, what I'm expecting that it will be 0, 1, 2. See, actually earlier in the third index, 40 is there, but now 40 is moving to 4. And 500 is moving to 5. See how I have inserted? I am trying to insert in between. So in place of in between 30 and 40, if I want to insert, I cannot move 30 forward. I can only move this one this way. Why I'm saying only we can move this way? Can anybody explain?
From zero index, it is starting the section.
Yes. So you can only expand this way, and hence you can only move the 40 towards it. And if 40 is having a lot of ego feeling and telling, why should I move? You move 30, it is illegal. Because you can only expand this way, you cannot expand this way. So to expand this way, you can just move the blocks of 40 and 500 towards from left to right and insert 20 in between. This is what insertion will do. So for this, I will write a small thing. If this is S pointing to. So for this, I will write S dot insert of what is the, because you know that you are trying to move 40 towards it. So instead of 40, you want to replace it with 20 because 40 is moving aside, right? In this position. So I will give, I want to insert in the third index. And what is the element I want to insert? 20. So this is the index in which you want to insert this element 20. So this is index I, this is element ELE. So it is telling that I want to insert this element 20 into the index I. Let us write the program for this. So I'll say student dot insert 3 comma 20. Let us see whether it will work or not. Right. So we have this created, and next you see here what has happened. The 40 is moving to 4-5 positions, and actually the 30 is still there in the same index, and the 20 is being inserted here. So you need to now understand that insertion function is very helpful to insert some values in between any of the list. You can also insert a list also itself. See how I will insert. I will insert something like 40, 34, 55. This is a list. See how I will insert here. So what you expect, how the appearance to be?
Sublist.
So, 3 will carry a value or a list or an address?
An address.
See, so 3 is carrying an address pointing to a list which is holding the elements 40, 34, 55, which I have just inserted into this one, the third index. So in this manner, wherever you want to insert, that index should be mentioned clearly, and the list or tuple or any number. So you can insert a number, you can insert a float, you can insert a string. Okay, you can insert a list, like how I have shown you. You can insert a tuple, you can insert a set or a dictionary or anything that you want. So basically you remember the syntaxes. Remembering syntax is very easy. If you can remember, it will be helpful to you. So naturally, the insert is always having two parameters. Always remember, one is an index in which you want to insert the element, and the next one is the element itself. So if the time permits, no, the time is up. So we have some other functions which you need to discuss. We have copy, clear, reverse, pop, count, everything. And we have good discussion in copy function actually. So in copy, if you understand copy function, you understand the entire memory of the list, how the list will be stored and how it will be done. So we should have a very good discussion on copy also. Okay, then I hope you understood up to now. Bye-bye everybody. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, sir.
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 Thank you, sir.